How are you guys this morning? Good. I know a whole bunch of your staff here, and it's a good bunch. Too many to name, but I do want to draw attention to one, and he's not here right now, which is probably good. Ben France? You guys know Ben? Yeah. Do you like Ben?
We love Ben.
If you like Ben, it's because I taught him everything he knew. So I want you to know that. And if you don't, I've never met him before. It was fun to run into Ben, you know, a long time ago here at Harvest, and he's a former student of mine. And I'm really happy to see that he's living proof that there is life after Moody. That's a really good thing. And I also was equally gratified to see that he actually has a job. That's a really good thing. So anyway, I love Ben. And I met Lauren this time for the first time as well. My wife is here, but I am under strict orders not to introduce her to you. So I'm not going to. But she's sitting right up there. That's my wife. So, yeah. All right, so grab your Bibles. Go to Joshua chapter 2. And we're going to be looking at Rahab. But by way of introduction, I just want to start with a little bit of a story, kind of. I was homesick from school one day. And I was just watching TV, laying around, didn't feel very good. And I came across Dr. Phil. And I remember watching the whole program, and, you know, I mean, I'm not particularly enamored with him, but I was bored and didn't feel good enough to do anything else. And I'll never forget, I had no idea who he was talking to or what the issue was, if Dr. Phil counsels on TV, kind of. But I remember he said something that's really stuck with me, and he said to whoever it was, "Life rewards action." I thought, that's pretty good. But I also thought, let's make it biblical and spiritual. God rewards action. We're going to see that, by the way, in Joshua chapter 2 with Rahab in just a second. Now, I am not one of these people who are going to say, yeah, God helps those who help themselves. I don't really believe that. I think we are utterly dependent upon God all the time for everything. But there is also a sense in which that statement is true. God does want us to activate our faith. He wants us to do certain things. And as often as not, when we do them, there's going to be huge blessings involved as we do those. That's what we're going to see as it relates to Rahab. So you guys are in Joshua chapter 2, right? Okay, so what we're going to find here is that for us to live as we should in our world and fulfill God's purpose that he has for us, we need to activate our faith. Just like Rahab did, she took four steps to do that, and we can do the same four steps. And when we activate our faith, there's blessings that come. And I'm not talking financial blessings. There are things much more important than financial blessings and financial prosperity. There's other things, but there are blessings that come to us when we do this. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to jump in Joshua chapter 2. Let me just say in Joshua chapter 1, we meet Joshua. We actually met him before. He comes up before this. But here's a man who fears God, and he has faith in God. And when we come to Joshua chapter 2, we meet another person who has faith in God and who fears God, and it affects her life. And that's a Canaanite whore named Rahab. Now, we oftentimes call her Rahab the harlot. Let's call her what she is. She's a prostitute. And yet, she is the hero of this episode. In fact, in many ways, she might be the hero of the whole conquest of Jericho because of what she does. So she activates her faith. Here's the first step that indicates how she did that. Number one, and for us too, we need to reexamine our allegiance. This is chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Verse 1, it says, "And Joshua the son of Nun sent two men secretly from Shittim as spies, saying, 'Go view the land, especially Jericho.' And they went and came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab and lodged there." We do not know exactly where Shittim was. We know where Jericho was. Jericho was in an interesting place. Let's suppose for a second, if this is north, and I don't know if it is or not, what direction is that? Somebody here knows.
North.
Tell me. What is that? You don't know? That's Southwest? I love it. I'm directionally challenged. And a lot of times if I turn a room into a map and I point north, somebody's going to go, that's not north. What's wrong with you? Just for the sake of illustration, okay? So let's suppose that's north. And let's suppose the Jordan River flows just like this, okay? From the north to the south. This little open area right here would be the Dead Sea. Okay, you with me? Jerusalem would be over there by the other set of stairs. Jericho is located like here, pretty close to the Jordan River. Shittim was probably this area over in here. We don't know for sure, but it's close, maybe 5 miles. How would you like to be a resident of Jericho and all of a sudden up march and they pitch camp away from you, 5 miles away from you, 2 million people? Would that freak you out a little bit? It'd freak me out. So what happens here is Joshua sends these spies to check out things, and they go to the house of a prostitute. And you might think, why did they do that? They're not supposed to, you know. Here's the deal. At the house of a prostitute, men might be seen coming and going rather frequently. Maybe even travelers and strangers might want to go find the place of a prostitute. And so they do this as an act of military strategy to not draw attention to themselves while they're there checking out Jericho. It doesn't actually work. Apparently, Rahab's house is sort of in an open area, an open neighborhood or something, and so the agents of the king of Jericho can see these men come, and they report that to the king. We're going to see that now. Verse 2. It was told to the king of Jericho, behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land. Then the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring out the men who have come to you, who entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land. Now, if in fact she's providing safe haven for them, that's treason. And we know from a host of ancient Near Eastern sources that treason in the ancient world was always ending in death. If you're a traitor, you're going to be executed. So you need to understand right out of the gate, Rahab is taking a great step of risk by housing these guys. It says in verse 4, but the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, true, the men came to me, but I did not know where they are from. And, she goes on in verse 5, when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. I do not know where the men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them. And so let me just say here, Rahab is lying. You guys see that? If you see that, would you just nod your head? She lies. Now, partly as a result of this, there are people who say that it's okay to lie. That if there's a clash of absolutes, is a term that comes up in this discussion. That is, if you have two absolute commands of God, like thou shalt not lie, or protect human life when it's about to be killed unjustly, that in that particular case, you have to go with the weightier matters of the law, which Jesus talks about in Matthew 23:23, that there are some aspects of some laws that really are more important and more critical for us than others. Jesus says that. And so in this case, you would opt for protecting life, and you might do so by lying. I don't think that that's the biblical thing to do. Rahab is never commended for her lie. She is commended for her faith and her actions, but never her lie. The consistent pattern in Scripture is, thou shalt not lie. We are not to lie. And I think that if we are faced in a situation that's serious, and we feel like it's necessary for us to lie, that God actually would provide a way for us to not do that. Now, I'm going to read an extended quote here from Corrie Ten Boom's book, The Hiding Place, right? She and her family hit a whole bunch of Jewish people. They were in Holland, okay? But that's, this episode is not about hiding Jewish people, but it's kind of related to this anyway. Here's the deal. During the German occupation of Holland, The Germans looked for young, healthy, strong Dutch men to come and work in their munitions factories. And they would just kidnap them and put them in sort of forced slave labor to do that kind of work. One day, two nephews of Corrie Ten Boom's came running into her house. At the house at that time, Corrie also had their sister, a niece of hers, who was there at the house. And the two nephews explained that the Germans were hard on their heels to get them and to take them away. And so this is what happens. I'm reading now. The Ten Booms had a little cellar in their kitchen with a trap door. And they were hiding some people there on occasion. So it was underneath an area rug, that trap door was to the cellar. Underneath an area rug, the kitchen table was on top of that. There was a tablecloth on the kitchen table. So they quick moved that stuff out of the way, opened the trap door. The nephews went down there, and that's where we pick up. We dropped the door shut, yanked the rug over it, and pulled the table back in place. With trembling hands, Betsy, Corey's sister, Cokie, their niece, and I threw a long tablecloth over it and started laying five places for tea. There was a crash in the hall as the front door burst open, and a smaller crash close by as Cokie dropped a teacup. Two uniformed Germans ran into the kitchen, rifles leveled. "Stay where you are, don't move." We heard boots storming up the stairs. The soldiers glanced around disgusted at this room filled with women and one old man. "Where are your men?" The shorter soldier asked Cokie in clumsy, thick-accented Dutch. "Well, these are my aunts," said Cokie, "and this is my grandfather. My father's at his school, and my mother is shopping, and I didn't ask you about the whole tribe." The man exploded in German. Then in Dutch, "Where are your brothers?" Cokie stared at him a second, then dropped her eyes. "My heart stood still," says Corrie. I knew how Nolly had trained her children, but surely, surely now of all times, a lie was permissible. "Do you have brothers?" asked the officer again. "Yes," Cokie said softly, "we have three. How old are they?" 21, 19, and 18. Upstairs, we heard the sounds of doors opening and shutting, the scrape of furniture dragged away from walls. "Where are they now?" the soldier persisted. Cokie leaned down and began gathering up the broken pieces of the cup she had dropped. The man jerked her upright. "Where are your brothers?" "The oldest one is at theological college. He doesn't get home most nights because..." "Well, what about the other two?" Cokie didn't miss a breath. "Why, they're under the table." Motioning us away from it with his gun, the soldier seized the corner of the tablecloth. At a nod from him, the taller man crouched with his rifle cocked. Then he flung back the tablecloth. At last, the pent-up tension exploded. Cokie burst into spasms of high, hysterical laughter. The soldiers whirled around. Was this girl laughing at them? "Don't take us for fools," the short one snarled. Furiously, he strode from the room, and minutes later, the entire squad trooped out. Not unfortunately before the silent soldier had spied and pocketed our precious packets of tea. So here, Cokie was able to get away with it. She said, "Yeah, they're under the table." Wasn't a lie. But God honored her commitment not to lie. And I think that that's how it's going to go for us. There are things that we can do and we can say to be able to avoid lying. You know, maybe she might have said, if the German soldiers would have come to the door, somebody might say, and they asked, "Are you harboring Jews here?" Holocaust days, right? "Are you harboring Jews here?" You might say, "Look, you think I would harbor Jews in light of the consequences?" You could say, why would I want to do that?" There's all kinds of other things that you could say. You could say, "Yeah, there's, 27,000 Jews in my living room right now." And that would probably be a lie, though. But I think that we don't have to lie. I don't think we should lie. I don't think it's right. And I think if our commitment to telling the truth and doing what's biblical gets us or somebody else in trouble, then maybe we have to suffer for righteousness' sake. What a novel idea. Verse 6 says, she had brought them up on the roof and hid them with the stalks of flax that she laid in order on the roof. You know, it was not unusual that in certain parts of the year, some time of the year, a lot of people that lived in the Middle East would have sort of a top floor, and they might put stuff up there to store. Or in this particular case, apparently, Rahab or some of her family members had gathered and harvested some flax. Flax was sort of a cereal crop, about that high. You could process it and get oil from it. You could actually process it also and turn it into a sort of linen, which was really prized. Most people wore wool stuff, and linen was much nicer to wear. But flax can be 3 or 4 feet high, and she's piled these things up, and these men are underneath, hiding there on her roof, and they did not see her. And then it says in verse 7, so the men pursued after them. You know, she says, go out, go catch them. The men pursued after them on the way to the Jordan as far as the fords, and the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone out. Now, the closing of the gate of Jericho is an important detail, because now the men are trapped inside the city. They are not readily and easily going to be able to get out. That would have been the easiest way. Just walk away from the whore's house and just leave. And so now things become really dicey, and they become super vulnerable and absolutely dependent upon Rahab. So the first thing that Rahab did and we should do is we got to re-examine our allegiance. Who are we going to listen to? Who are we going to follow? Second, another step to activate our faith, we've got to recognize God's power. Verse 8. Before the men lay down, and there's evidence here in the text that they spent the night more or less, or a good part of the night at Rahab's house, and now they're probably actually bedding down, maybe underneath the flax. She came up to them on the roof and said to the men, I know that the Lord has given you the land, and the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea, and when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. That relays and refers to an episode in Numbers chapter 21. So I just want you to know that the Red Sea episode happened more than 40 years before this. But the residents of Jericho and others there in the land of Canaan heard about this. They knew about this. And their victory over the Amorites. Verse 11, as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted. There was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. That statement at the end of verse 11, by the way, is a confession of saving faith. Before the spies ever showed up, she'd heard about what the God of Israel had done, and she believed it and believed in him. There's three things that are revealed here about her faith. She believes that Israel God has dominion over the entire cosmos. He's the God in the heavens above and earth beneath. That he is truly God. This is the second thing, that he is truly God. Unlike Baal, the Asherah, Marduk, Ishtar, the other names of the Canaanite gods. And thirdly, when it says in the heavens above and on earth beneath, the other times where that same phrase is used in the Old Testament, it refers to God's sovereign control over those things. And so he's sovereign. She has a considerable amount of theological savvy here. And I want to propose that she is saved. Now, before we go on, let me just say, if this is saving knowledge, and I think the book of Hebrews chapter 11, where she occurs again, and in James chapter 2, where she occurs again, also indicate that that's the case. If this is saving knowledge, I want you to notice that if she would have died in the conquest of Jericho, she would have gone to heaven. The thing is, when she activated her faith by hiding the spies and striking an agreement with them, she was spared. And that's a pretty important lesson for us, as we're going to see. That if we are saved and we have saving faith, when we live that faith out, when we activate that faith, there's blessings that come to us. Not unlike what she went through. Now, those blessings can include a bunch of things. We're going to talk about this a little bit more in a little bit. But just at this point, that's what's going on. She has a great knowledge about God. She believes it's true. I think she's saved. But she does more than that. And in this life, gets blessed. So we got to re-examine our allegiance. We have to recognize God's power. Here's the third step to really do what God wants us to do and to activate our faith. We have to remove the barriers, verses 12 to 14. Now then, she says, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with my father's house, and give me a sure sign that you will save alive my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. And so she strikes a deal with them. And they agree to it. Verse 14, the men said to her, I lie for yours, even to death. If you do not tell this business of ours, then when the Lord gives us the land, we will deal kindly and faithfully with you. That is, Rahab, if you don't give us up, and if you don't disclose our plans of invasion, the conquest, then we will make sure that when we come here, we'll protect you. Here's the fourth step. We got to respond with obedience, verses 15 to 21. It says, then she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was built into the city wall, so that she lived in the wall. And I don't think, by the way, but this is probably like, 90 feet or something like that. It might have been 20 feet. It didn't take a huge, super high wall to be able to defend your city pretty well. And at least in the case of Jericho, it wouldn't have mattered anyway, right? And she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was built into the city wall, so she lived in the wall. And she said to them, go into the hills, or the pursuers will encounter you, and hide there 3 days until the pursuers have returned. Then afterward, you may go your way. The men said to her, we will be guiltless with respect to this oath of yours that you have made us swear. Behold, verse 18, when we come into the land, you shall tie this scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down. And you shall gather into your house your father, mother, brothers, all your father's household. Well, talk about the scarlet cord just for a second. Can you tell of another place where the Hebrew people had to be inside? That they put something red on the outside of, an entry place or an opening into their house, that as long as you stayed inside, you were going to be safe. What does that sound like? Sound like the Passover? It does, doesn't it? And whereas it's red blood that gets put on the lintel, a lintel is the top piece that goes across a doorway entrance, and the doorposts are the parts that go up and down. Whereas it was red blood from the sacrificed Passover lamb that saved them. Now it's a red cord, not in a doorway, but now in a window that's going to rescue Rahab and all of her family as long as they stay inside. And the spies make that point. Don't be wandering outside when we show up here. In verse 19, if anyone goes out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head, then he shall be guiltless. And they agree to this. They strike this bargain. It says they depart into the hills. I'm guessing that probably somehow Rahab told them another way to get out of the city, where they could go and be undetected and escape and get away. And so sure enough, they go away. They stay away for 3 days. I'm guessing that all the searching for them settles down at this point. And then they go back to Shittim, to where the other Hebrews are and where Joshua is. And they make this great report. It says in verse 23, then the two men returned. They came down from the hills and passed over and came to Joshua, the son of Nun, and they told him all that happened to them. And they said to Joshua, truly the Lord has given all the land into our hands, and also all the inhabitants of the land melt away because of us. And then here's the last thing. We can reap the rewards. And here, guys, here, I want you to go to James chapter 2. Because in James chapter 2, we have, I think, sort of the theological, not narrative, statement about the significance of Rahab. Now, James chapter 2 is a really puzzling passage. The whole Bible talks about how, you know, we are justified by grace through faith, not by works. And then James chapter 2 says, no, you're justified by works. So I can't deal with all the details here, but let me give you a little bit, just a sort of the Cliff's Notes of what's going on here. Take a look at James chapter 2, verse 14. It says, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Then there's this statement, can that faith save him? Well, in the book of James, the idea, this verb saving, is used five times, and it's never used for the salvation from the eternal consequences of sin. Not in James's book. It's never used that way. It's always used to talk about, you know, rescuing yourself and preserving for yourself, for yourself the abundant life or something like that. Okay, so what good is it? And then he illustrates that in verse 15. If a brother or sister is poorly clothed, lacking daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm, be filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? Notice, it's no good to have faith without works. To have saving faith without works is no good in this life. Take a look at verse 17. So also faith by itself, that is, if we as saved people, people saved by faith, if we are not activating our faith, if faith is by its works, but without any works, if it's by itself, without any works, then that faith is dead. What does that mean? Well, in the context here, it doesn't do you any good. Take a look at verse 20. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Okay, so here's the thing. In James chapter 2, it's not talking about how you got to have works to be saved, and if you don't have works, you're not saved. It's talking about how if you have saving faith, and then you live that faith out, then it's good, it's useful, it's helpful. If you don't, you're going to die and go to heaven, but that faith is dead in terms of its usefulness for you in this life. We have a tendency to want to take everything in James 2 and say, this is talking about eschatological, future judgment. It's talking about eternal life. No. It goes on. It uses the example of Abraham. Verse 21, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? We got to read that verse real carefully. When did Abraham offer up Isaac on the altar? It's in Genesis chapter 22. Where does the book of Genesis say, and Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness? Where does that occur? How about chapter 15 and verse 6? If, in fact, Abraham is saved in Genesis 15, 6, then in what sense is he justified in Genesis 22 when he offers up Isaac? Well, here's the thing. The word justified is used four other places in the Bible for showing yourself to be justified, for showing yourself that you are righteous already. It's not the cause of the righteousness, but it's a demonstration of that. And I'll read you the verses. If you want, you got to write this down really fast because I'm not going to read them for you myself. Here are the addresses. Okay? Luke 7:29, Luke 7:35. 7:29, 35, Romans 3:4, and 1 Timothy 3:16. All use the word justified, not to say this is how you got saved, but to say this is demonstrating that you are justified. That's the idea here. So, just to be very clear, Abraham is saved in Genesis 15, but he shows that he's saved in Genesis 22, right? When he offers up Isaac. And by the way, in the wake of that, of him doing that, Abraham has another profound encounter with God, which he hasn't had, according to the book of Genesis, for about 20 years. God shows up in Genesis 22. In other words, Abraham has huge blessings when he activated his saving faith he already had. by a deeper encounter with God. And three other times in the Old Testament, Abraham indicates that he gains a great reputation because he's called the friend of God. Okay, so he activates the saving faith that he has, and he gets blessed in this life. It's even more clear with Rahab. Look at the next verse. In the same way, verse 25, let's skip down to verse 25. In the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works? Remember, she showed herself that she's justified by works. She shows by the works that she's justified. When she received the messengers and sent them out by another way. You have to recall as well, keep in mind the order of what's going on in Joshua chapter 2. Before the spies ever show up, she believes in the God of heaven. She's saved then. And then she shows it and activates her faith when the spies are there. But activating her faith there when the spies are there is not what saved her. That knowledge of God is what saved her. So here's the point. To the degree that we add works to our saving faith, the saving faith being that which gains for us eternal life, to the degree we add works to that saving faith, to the degree we activate our saving faith, is the degree to which we're going to have blessings in this life. Did Rahab receive blessings? Yeah, she stayed alive. And she's also, by the way, in the genealogy of Jesus in Matthew chapter 1. Did you guys know that? She's there. And we know who she married later. She married one of the prominent princes from the tribe of Judah. In other words, she married a man of influence and means. She married money. There's a blessing there because she activated her faith. So, just to illustrate, can you see this? Do you know what this is? Tell me, all of you, tell me. Unicycle. Now, I don't look like it, but I'm an avid mountain biker. Mountain biking is riding a bike on dirt trails through the woods. And the trails have rocks and roots and ruts. The three R's of mountain biking. Rocks, roots, ruts. I could take this and ride it on a mountain bike trail. Believe it or not, how many of you think I can ride this unicycle? How many of you think I can ride it? I can't. I just don't want to right now. So, I can. I could take this on a mountain bike trail and I could ride it. And I can get from point A to point B. I'm here to tell you it wouldn't be very fast and it wouldn't be much fun. I know that for a fact. It wouldn't be much fun. You know what makes it fun? Is if I could add stuff to this unicycle. Like if I could add handlebars and another wheel and gears and brakes and suspension. Then I could go faster and I would have more fun. And what I would have would look like this bad boy. Now you all go, ooh. This is my mountain bike. This is a Santa Cruz Tall Boy, which is kind of ironic that I would ride a bike named Tall Boy. That's rather strange, isn't it? You know, have you ever noticed, do you know why bikes can't stand up by themselves? It's because they're too tired. So anyway, I thought that was funny, but apparently not. I'm here to tell you, when you take this thing on a trail, it's exhilarating. It's a thrill. It is so much fun. Have they had pictures of me up there, mountain biking? Yeah, are you going to put pictures of me up there, guys? Did you already? Okay. That was taken a while ago. This is a blast. This, not so much. This will get you where you need to go. And so the Christian life is kind of like a mountain bike. if you add stuff, that gets to be exhilarating and exciting. There's a blessing associated with activating our faith. And maybe that's going to mean for some of us, it's going to mean, you know, let's start praying. Let's read our Bible more in a meaningful way. Let's spend more time in worship or in fellowship with other believers. Or let's witness to our friends a little bit more. Let's do some of these things. Is there a risk involved with doing all of that? Well, yeah. But I'm here to tell you guys that like Abraham, like Rahab, we activate our faith. God pours out blessings then. You know, we don't. We're going to miss out on those things. Rahab would have died. And as it is, she has a great life after this. She activated her faith. So I want to encourage you to just be thinking about the things in your life where you know as a Christian you haven't done much in a particular area maybe. I'm just here to tell you that if you will start doing some of those things, your life will be different. It'll be better. It'll be more joyous, more thrilling. The Christian life will become more exhilarating if you do that. Let's pray. So, Father, make it so, would you please? Would you help us to understand that the saving faith we have gets us to heaven? That's the biggest part of this. There's no question about that. But like Rahab, when we activate that, there's blessings that come to us now before we die. And which of us doesn't want that? I just want to pray for any of the folks that might be here today who kind of feel like their spiritual life might be flat. Maybe there's something that's just missing. And so I pray, Father, that you would remind us and impress upon us the importance of adding to the saving faith we have good works, because it'll change our lives when we do that. Please, Father, make it so. In Jesus' name we pray, and the whole church said, amen.